And I'll say thank you to Carol for her words of welcome, and I'll extend my welcome to you, whether you're here or whether you're watching at home. You are indeed very welcome as we come to worship. Just a few little things. With regard to our conference, yes, it is available online. If you go onto irishmethodist.org, you'll be able to watch the business. And then there's evening sessions that are normally a form of worship service. They will all be streamed live, as will the installation service. That's the installation of our new president, which will take place on Wednesday evening. Again, available online. And if you're one who has received the new Methodist newsletter, that's your new incoming president. That's the Reverend Dr. Sari Mbasu on the front of the newsletter there. And Sari will be ratified at conference on Wednesday as taking over. And then we will also find out during conference who the new president designate is to take over after Sari, and who the new leader will be after Mrs. Hazel Loney. So all those nice little interesting things, and you can listen to the discussions and debates if you so desire. But before we sing our praises to God, let's hear from God's word. Reading from Psalm 138 and reading the first five verses. Psalm 138, first five verses. I will praise you, O Lord, with all of my heart. Before the gods I will sing your praises. I will bow down toward your holy temple and will praise your name for your love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted above all things your name and your word. When I called, you answered me. You made me bold and stout-hearted. May all the kings of the earth praise you, O Lord. When they hear of the words of your mouth, may they sing of the ways of the Lord, for the glory of the Lord is great. And we end there at verse 5, and we do indeed want to praise the Lord. And to that end, we will turn to our mission praise. It's number 307. The words will appear on the screen. You obviously don't have the books available to you, but 307. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. And we'll sing it through at least twice. And remember, you're talking about and you're singing about entering his courts with praise. So you can't do that. I can't see whether you're smiling or not. But let's raise our voices in praise of our God. Thank you. And now we turn to prayer, and we come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Father, we come. We come before you to praise you and celebrate and magnify your holy name. For you, Lord, are great, and your word has been exalted above all nations. So, Father, thank you for the blessings that you bestow upon us each day. On a day when the sun is shining and we can see the beauty of your creation in all of its splendor. We say thank you, Lord, for the wonder of the world in which we dwell. From snow-capped mountains to deep green valleys to the roaring oceans, Father, all are yours and were created by your spoken word. You truly are a majestic God, and we want to worship you and praise you. And while you have blessed us with so many things in the physical realm, Lord, we are also aware that you have blessed us with an even greater gift, because you gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior and Lord. He left those realms of glory with you and came to be a man among men, to live a human life, to know all its weaknesses and frailties, and yet, Lord, lived a life that was without sin. And then, in accordance with your will, and when the time was right, he offered his sinless life upon a cross as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. And yes, Father, we have to acknowledge that each one of us has sinned. So we come before your throne of grace and mercy and ask for forgiveness in Jesus' name. And then, Lord, we make bold because we ask for something more. The passage we read there told us that you made us bold and stout-hearted. We are bold and stout-hearted, Lord, when we ask for an assurance of sins forgiven because Jesus died. And then you sent your Holy Spirit, Lord, to be with us. So by your Spirit, Lord, move amongst us this day. Reassure us of sins forgiven and strengthen us for the tasks to which you have called us, and strengthen us that we may worship you in spirit and in truth, and to give you all the glory, all the honor that befits your holy name. And Lord, we would also say thank you for the offerings that have been presented, and we trust that you will multiply them and guide us in how we use them to your honor and glory. These things we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. Now, I'm going to ask Nigel to put up a slide for you there. Do any of you recognize those jars? No? Yes? No? Maybe you do. I'm showing you those for a very simple reason. A number of years ago, there was a range of TV commercials, and in it they showed jars like those, glass jars, some that had been decorated, being put to many different uses. In one, it was a child was using a jar like that for its pens and pencils. Then there was one that somebody had decorated and was using it as a vase for their flowers. Another one, it was a little bit rougher looking because it was an artist that was using it to store all their paintbrushes in. Some of them, like those ones, had been decorated. And I was informed this morning after Ballymoney that those designs were actually by Orla Keeley. Do you remember what jars they were on? And what the advertiser was really getting out was that not that those glass jars could be put to multiple uses, but what were they trying to advertise? Can you remember? No? No? No idea. Somebody set it up there. Coffee. Right, Nigel. There you are. That's to prove that they wear coffee jars by Dia Egberts. And see that green one in the middle? If your eyesight's good enough, I think that's actually mint-flavored coffee. I don't think I ever tried it. It's hazelnut. Yeah. Oh, is there one on mint?
No.
No? Well, there was a mint one. I can assure you of that because I avoided it. Because one of the jars was actually bought because it matched the tiles in the kitchen. Have you any of you got jars like that about the house? Or other jars that you've maybe painted yourselves? Or decorated or put to other use? You've got a jar for something and you use it for something else. Many of you use coffee jars for storing other things in. Buttons and the like. Uh-huh. Now, the reason I'm showing you those jars and talking to you about them is that the advertisers on behalf of Dow Egberts wanted you to know that what was special about them was what had been in them. The coffee. Wasn't that lovely? Hazelnut coffee's not too bad, but mint I wouldn't even consider. Now, in our reading, we're going to hear not about glass jars, but about jars of clay. And I'm going to ask Miriam to come and read this for us. Thank you, Miriam.
The reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 to 12. And I'm reading it from the New Translation, not the NIV. And so, since God in his mercy has given us this wonderful ministry, we never give up. We reject all shameful and underhand methods. We do not try to trick anyone, and we do not distort the word of God. We tell the truth before God, and all who are honest know it. If the good news we preach is veiled from anyone, it is a sign that they are perishing. Satan, the god of this evil world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe, so that they are unable to see the glorious light of the good news that is shining upon them. They don't understand the message we preach about the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. We don't go around preaching about ourselves. We preach Christ Jesus, the Lord. All we say about ourselves is that we are your servants because of what Jesus has done for us. The God who said, "Let there be light in the darkness," has made us understand that this light is the brightness of the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. But this precious treasure, this light and power that shines within us, is held in perishable containers, as your clay jars. That is, in our weak bodies. So everyone can see that our glorious power is from God and it is not our own. We are pressed on every side by troubles, but we are not crushed and broken. We are perplexed, but we don't give up and quit. We are hunted down, but God never abandons us. We get knocked down, but we get up again and keep going. Through suffering, these bodies of ours constantly share in the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be seen in our bodies. Yes, we live under constant danger of death because we serve Jesus, so that the life of Jesus will be obvious in our dying bodies. So we live in the face of death, but it has resulted in eternal life for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We say thank you to Miriam for reading that for us. Miriam read there, what was it? It wasn't clay jars, Miriam. It was perishable containers and earthen vessels in the King James, if you want to go there. But Nigel, could you put the slide up? Because this is the verse I want to focus on this morning. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God, not from us. And I want to try to look at that verse under three sort of headings this morning. Three little headings. The clay jars, or the jars of clay, the treasure, and then where the treasure comes from. Hopefully, clear enough little steps to follow. And so we'll start with the clay jars. And when you think of it, if you go back to Genesis chapter 2, where you have the creation narratives, there you can actually read in 2:7 that it states that, "Then the Lord God formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being." So that tells us there that God formed our ancestor, Adam, from the dust of the earth, from clay, if you like. Now, I know, and I had this confirmed for me, that clay is not really prized as a growing medium. If you have a clay garden, apparently it's not very good for growing certain things. So farmers aren't necessarily happy with clay soil. But God took clay, dust of the earth, and turned it into something remarkable, into human beings, into Adam. Now, clay, when it's worked and shaped, can become very valuable and precious to certain people. How many of you have bits of Donegal china or Balik china in your homes? Yes? Yeah, quite a few of you have. And have any of you ever visited the Balik factory? Yeah? And you saw people making and shaping all of that with maybe a flattened nail or broken razor blade or whatever. That's just a bit of pottery and clay. But when they work it and they put it all together and then they bake it and it reduces in the ovens and all the rest of it, don't you treasure it and cherish it? You think it's very special. Especially if it's one of those woven baskets. You know, the wee tiny flowers on it? Yeah, try buying one of them and you find out how precious they are. But when Paul the Apostle was talking about clay jars, he wasn't talking about something that has been fashioned to be just an ornament. He was talking about something that was made for everyday use. The clay jars he would have been thinking of and comparing himself to and all believers to was the clay pots that would have been used to store things like water, oil, wine, flour, grain. And in some instances, those clay pots were actually used to store precious documents. The documents were put in and then it was sealed with another piece of clay. And they can protect, a sealed clay pot can protect. The 1940s, 1950s, I'm sure some of you have heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls. When a shepherd boy was out minding his sheep and he used his sling to drive something away and he heard a clink when a stone went into a cave and he climbed in after it and he discovered clay jars, one of which he'd broken, but in the jars were scrolls that dated back to the first century. Dated back to the time of Jesus and after it. And that was in clay jars. So those clay jars that Paul was thinking about were ordinary, everyday vessels. Tell me, how many of you have got ordinary, everyday using implements in your home that are made of clay or china or something like that? Do any of them have a little chip on them? Yeah? Maybe a crack? Do you throw them out right away or do you keep on using them? From a hygiene point of view, we should dump them, shouldn't we? But we tend to keep on using them and sometimes we hold on to them because, oh, that was so-and-so's mug or that's my mug and it's special to me. jars, clay pots, and use get cracked and chipped. Paul was saying that the believers are clay pots. How many of us have gone through life without having the odd little chip, the odd little knock? How many of us could say that we're in pristine condition? You know, we're in the top physical condition we could be in. We're top emotionally, mentally, and spiritually. Everything's just absolutely perfect with us. Isn't that right? I don't see too many of you agreeing with me. Aren't we all a wee bit cracked? Thank you, Miriam. We can all be a wee bit cracked. We're the cracked pots. Not necessarily cracked pots, but we're cracked. That's what he was talking about here. Paul was saying that we, the believers, are like those clay pots that can be cracked. But we have a treasure within. We have a treasure within. So what is that treasure? What's the treasure we have? It's not something that you can go out and buy. You can't even get it if you perform some miraculous deed of valor or such good works. It has to be obtained by receiving it as a gift. And it is a gift that comes from God the Father. And it deals with having a relationship with Him. Imagine that. The Creator of the universe, who spoke and things came into being, wants a relationship with you and me. So how does that come and be within us? The treasure that is so special. How come it's within us? When you think of treasures, many of you have ever gone over to London to see the crown jewels in the Tower of London. Some of you have done that. And was it easy to get in? Or did you have to go through all the security checks and all the rest of it? And could you actually touch the crown jewels? Any of them setting out for you to touch? No? That's because people class them as valuable. But we have a treasure that can't be bought with jewels or gold or money. And it's within us. And it's there. Because it's to be accessible. It's there to be handled, to be seen, to be felt. Do you ever watch the fine art programs, Antiques Roadshow and the like on TV? And sometimes they will show you an exquisite piece of art. And the presenters aren't even allowed to touch it. Or maybe they have to wear gloves to touch it. But sometimes the things are classed as too valuable to be touched. The treasure we have within is to be seen. It is to be felt. It is to be touched. It's to be experienced. Because it's hid. It's stored in earthen vessels like you and me. In clay pots that have the odd crack. And what is that treasure? It's to know God as Lord and Savior. It's to know Jesus Christ as the one who died and rose again for our salvation. That's the treasure we hold. That's the message that we have. That's the message that we have to proclaim. Jars of clay. We can be put to many uses. And we're not always seen as being the most treasured things. But by faith, we can have something that is beyond price within us. We can have that treasure. The treasure, where does the treasure come from? The treasure comes from God. Let's look at that verse again from 2 Corinthians 4, verse 7. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. This power, this treasure, it's not ours. It's not man-made. It's not come about because we live good lives. It's received as a gift from God. God created humankind for a purpose. And that purpose was to be in a living relationship with Him. To enjoy His company. To be present. But mankind, humankind failed. And sin entered in. And that relationship with God was broken. The clay became marred. But God had a plan to restore the relationship. That plan was sending His Son Jesus Christ into the world. Jesus Christ came, lived as a man among men, and died upon a cross. You see the difference between us and Jesus. Yes, He was human in every sense, but He did something that we are incapable of doing. He lived a life that was sinless. He lived a sinless life. And when the time was right and in accordance with God's will, He gave His life as an atoning sacrifice that we might be forgiven. That we might enter into that relationship with God, it might be restored. And when Christ died and rose again, and then was exalted into heaven, He promised His disciples that He would send them another counselor, a comforter, who would come and dwell within them. And when you put your faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you receive that gift of the Holy Spirit to come and dwell within you, to dwell within the clay jar, the earthen vessel. The Holy Spirit is the treasure because God in Himself dwells within us. And what does He want from us? We're the earthen vessels that contain the treasure. But are we to keep the treasure stored within, like the earthen vessels that were found in that cave in the 1950s, 1940s, that had been sealed and nothing had gone in or out for all that time? We're the cracked, we're the chipped earthen vessels. And if you have an earthen vessel or a glass or a mug with a crack in it, what sometimes happens? You know? Leaks. It leaks. Are we allowing the Holy Spirit that is within us by faith in Jesus to leak out? Does the light shine out from us? The light of God shine out? Does the love of Christ seep out through us to those around us? Are we displaying that we hold that treasure within for others to see, for others to experience, for others to touch? Because doesn't it say that we are His hands, we are His feet, to reach out for Him? He wants to use us. Are we willing to be used in His service as earthen vessels, maybe for a mundane task, maybe for a special purpose, but are we allowing the treasure that is within to impact the lives of those around us, that they too can come to know Christ as Lord and Savior? Let's take time to pray. Father, we thank You that while we have our faults and failings, we can come to You, know forgiveness, and offer ourselves to be used by You, to be those containers, to be those vessels that take Your love, your word, your compassion to those around us. And Father, we would on this day begin to pray for our Methodist conference that will be taking place later this week. Youth night took place last night. But Father, for the business that will be conducted in the coming days, we pray for wisdom, for guidance, for direction in the discussions that take place, in the decisions that are made. Father, may they all be in accordance with your will, that the Methodist Church in Ireland may be one that serves you and serves you alone. And Father, we would think of those who will be taking up office. We think of Dr. Sari Ambassu and his wife Clodagh and their children as Sari enters into this presidential year. We ask for strength, for guidance, for protection, and wisdom as he carries out his duties as president of the Methodist Church. And for votes that will be taken for the president designate and the new lay leader, we ask, Lord, for wisdom in the part of those who will make the decisions about who that will be, to lead us forward, to guide us. And Father, for the circuits that are involved this year with changes of ministers and ministers who are being changed and restationed, we ask, Lord, that you will move in every setting, that the ministers will know your leading and guiding, and the congregations who either say farewell or welcome will indeed be open to your prompting and work together with those who come to minister among them. And Father, we would also think of our government at this time, both in Stormont and in Westminster, as they continue to lead us and guide the way through this pandemic. We pray that they will continue to have wisdom as new variants of this disease are discovered. We ask, Lord, that they will make the right decisions for the safety of the people and the nation. And as they deal, Lord, with the situation surrounding Brexit and the potential for disruption that is causing with the protocol here for Northern Ireland, we ask for wisdom far beyond their own as they seek to solve these problems, that things may go smoothly and that there will be a benefit for all peoples in Britain, in Ireland and the rest of Europe. Father, just guide and lead there. For our medical staff in our hospitals who are still treating people who are ill and treating others who have been delayed in their treatment as a result of backlog and patient waiting lists. So Father, grant them the energy and the strength they need. And for those, Lord, who are awaiting operations and awaiting treatment, we pray that you will grant them the grace to wait and the patience and the strength and the courage that they will require. And Father, for our life together as a people in this church, in this fellowship, we pray that you will lead, you will guide, and you will direct, so that all that we do will be honouring to you, will give you the glory. Father, all of our prayers we lay before your throne in the name of Jesus, our Saviour and Lord. Amen. We'll be moving shortly to our communion, but before we go, we'll sing together. It's from the Mission Praise. It's 414. And let us break bread together on our knees. And we'll be using the traditional version.
Let us break bread together on our knees. Let us break bread together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, O Lord, have mercy on me. Let us drink wine together on our knees. Let us drink wine together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy on me. Let us praise God together on our knees. Let us praise God together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy on me.
And so we turn to the words of our communion service, and your responses are those in bold type. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Now we move to the saying of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And we look for a resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And so we move to the thanksgiving, and you just remain seated. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, it is indeed right, it is our joy and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. You created all things and made us in your own image. When we had fallen into sin, you gave your only Son to be our Savior. He shared our human nature and died on a cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand in glory, where he lives forever to pray for us. Through him you have sent your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us your people, a royal priesthood, to stand before you to proclaim your glory and celebrate your mighty acts. And so with all the company of heaven, we join in the unending hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise you, Lord God, King of the universe, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this and eat it. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Therefore, Father, as he has commanded us, we do this in remembrance of him. We ask you to accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we who receive your gifts of bread and wine may share in the body and the blood of Christ. Make us one body with him. Accept us as we offer ourselves to be a living sacrifice, and bring us with the whole creation to your heavenly kingdom. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be given to you, Almighty Father, from all who dwell on earth and in heaven, throughout all ages. Amen. The bread we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in the one loaf. The prayer of humble access comes next, and I would ask you to say this with me. Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy and not in any goodness of our own. We are not worthy even to gather up the crumbs under your table, but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with your body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us. Amen. And so I invite you to draw near with faith, to receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for us, and his blood which was shed for us, and we will feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. And so, the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for us, keep us in eternal life. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for us, keep us in eternal life. We drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for us, and we are thankful. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all mankind. Amen. Amen. And so we turn to our closing hymn for now. And that is, I serve a risen Saviour. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. Thank you.
I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near.
He lives,
Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along my narrow way. lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way.
He lives,
salvation to impart. You ask me how. And sing eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind.
He lives,
Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along my narrow way.
Then we come to our closing prayers. The blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace in the power of the Spirit to live and work to God's praise and glory. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen.